building awareness of local resources that will change your destiny's compass is Tarsha Weary's number one goal.
I wanted to create something that would give people an inside peek at the heart, soul, and struggle of true entrepreneurs.
Do you feel stuck in one place? Have you been looking for practical steps that you can use to guide you through the hardest times in your journey? Then you've tuned in at the right time to the right place.
I like to think of myself as the business consultant for the next generation. I want them to know that they may possess a billion-dollar idea, so don't underestimate yourself.
The only on-demand, inspirational, motivational show that is geared towards connecting minorities to local business owners and resources.
I really want to use this platform to show people how to want more out of life and that they need to do more to achieve that goal. You really can be more than what your current situation is dictating to you.
Listen live every Sunday starting at 8 a.m. Eastern Standard Time to join in on the conversation.
10% luck, 20% skill, 15% concentrated power of will, 5% pleasure, 50% pain, and 100% reason to remember the name.
Without further delay, here's the host of Controlling Your Future, Tarsha Weary.
Hello and welcome to Controlling Your Future. I'm your host, Tarsha Weary, and I'm so excited that you've decided to take the next 30 minutes of your day and share it with me. I plan to impart wisdom, enlightenment, hope, and passion into your vision that I know you're holding inside of you. So on today's show, I have an exciting guest. Robert L. Wallace is the president and CEO of the bith-group and bith-technologies based out of Baltimore, Maryland. You will not believe what I got him to discuss in a pre-recorded conversation about business, family, and the desire to achieve your goals. I do these shows on Sunday because it gives me the opportunity to give thanks to the Creator for all the gifts received, whether through a dream, whether it's imparted into you from another person, or something has happened in your life that has given you a driven purpose that you just cannot shake. Let's take this moment to give thanks for our gifts with a song. I believe that there is a song for every emotion that you're feeling. Then I'll come back with some invaluable information that will help you on your journey to live in a successful and purposeful life.
I'm so confused. I know I heard you loud and clear, so I followed through. Somehow I ended up here. I don't wanna think, I may never understand, that my broken heart is a part of your plan. When I try to pray, all I got is hurt and these four words.
Hillary Scott and the Scott family with Thy Will. You see, I've learned in my journey towards success that it was never my plan that I've been following. It has always been a higher calling in my life. No matter what barricade that has or will try to present itself in my life, following my purpose always has seemed to get me through it. If you find that you're stuck, you might want to start empowering yourself with messages like this. It will get you through some really tough times, which are bound to happen because you never learn anything from success. Really think about what I just said. You never learn anything from your successes. You learn through your failures. Remember that while you are going through a hard time, don't quit because you failed at something. Take it as the answer to the test that you are going to have to retake, but next time you will pass. I'm encouraging you to get to the next test. Go to the next step. So what is controlling your future about, you may ask? Is it a godly show? Is it a ministry? Is it a life coaching show? Well, it's everything you need to control your future. If you are lacking encouragement to keep going, this is the show for you. If you don't know where to start to fulfill your purpose that you've been given, well, this is the show for you too. If you lack financial resources, this is the show that will teach you techniques that will allow you to structure your business to receive it, to receive finances, no matter what the business vision is. So over the next few months, I'll be building structure for you. No live shows, but as we progress, I want to coach you through whatever it is you need, which will make this an interactive show at some point. However, this is also my time to pass your qualification test. Am I qualified to help you? Do I know what I'm talking about? Or how can I really help you no matter where you are the answers that I want to answer to gain your trust, and hopefully you will spread the word to encourage someone else. So each show, I plan to interview a CEO, president, and founder of a multi-million dollar company. Ask them to pour out their hearts to you, to share with you their failures as a guide. Now, I'm going to play this interview of myself and Robert L. Wallace, the president and CEO of bith-group and bith-technologies. When I come back, I'm going to pull the nuggets and the jewels out of the conversation so you can become wealthy in spirit, which can never be taken from you. So listen in.
So the first question I wrote down is based on, and I want to make sure I'm going in some kind of flow. So what legacy did you expect or do you expect to leave for your children? I read that you have seven or have heard it.
So I have five biological and two that are kind of adopted. So you can say seven.
So seven children. Yeah. So what legacy did you want to leave for them?
I think the legacy I want to leave for my kids is one of possibilities, the ability to dream and to dream big, right? Two will be relationship with God, because with God, all things are possible. So your dreams that may seem far-fetched, but when you are in God, then they are very doable. Because what God will do is God will take your natural and his super and make it supernatural. So you can do supernatural things, at least according to people. And I think the third thing, legacy I would leave is to have impact. Whatever you do, it should have impact beyond yourself or beyond your family. It should impact humanity. So everything that I try to do today, it's not about just making money. It's not about, you know, bith-group being this size or whatever. It is to have impact such that when I take my last breath on earth and you guys come to my funeral, you guys will say, I hope Bob made an impact on my life. Or Bob made an impact on the community. Or Bob made an impact on society. Bob made an impact on the kingdom of God. If you guys say that, I'm gonna rest in peace.
Yeah. Okay. So, out of your children, and I'm only asking because this is like a question most entrepreneurs don't even think about. Right. So we want our children to follow our footsteps. Out of your seven children, biological or not, do you have any that are in your footsteps now?
I have a couple. Okay. I mean, I think all my kids One are entrepreneurial. All of them have started businesses already. We got one who's still in the business with me. At one time, I had three in the business with me. So they are all my kids are entrepreneurial. All my kids think big. I had got one kid who he went to Stanford Business School, started a software company. He was like 25, 26. By the time he's 28, he's a multimillionaire. So all of my children have been infected with this bug called entrepreneurship, right? And they all think big. So, and I have a very smart wife. She's very smart, she's very beautiful. And thank God the kids take after her. Mm-hmm. They're intelligent and they're good looking. So I had nothing to do with it. It's all their mother. Okay. But they are all entrepreneurs.
Okay. So what is one of the main challenges in coming into your business that you think they had to overcome?
Well, I think when you are the founder's child, I mean, it's a lot of pressure to come into a company because people in the company don't know how to deal with you.
Right.
So they respect you because you're the founder's or CEO's child, but they also want to know, okay, what do you bring to the party? So I think there's a great deal of pressure on children that come into a family business. Me and my wife and I, our guidelines have always been, before the kids come into the business, we want them to go work for somebody else. Mm-hmm. Go out in the world, work 3 years for somebody else, then come see me. Right? Okay. I want them to know how it feels, right, to be out there on your own and have to work, you know, in an environment where there may not be family. You may not know people. I want them to know how it feels so that if they do come working for the business, for the family business, then they will have appreciation for what we've given them and what it means. And you won't have that until you go out in the real world, right?
Right.
And fight for yourself and see how brutal it is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then you come in to the family business, to the family cocoon, and then we'll nurture you and hopefully get you to where you need to be.
And there's a level of appreciation.
That's true.
Not get if they didn't
sure
go out.
Mm-hmm. And not at all.
So you speak very well. Every time I watch any of your videos, you speak extremely well.
I'm old.
You've been doing this. So what are a few tips that you can give to the youth to mastering this technique that you have, or speaking to the public?
Sure. Mm-hmm. I think there are three things. And this is true. For anyone, did you see President Obama's speech last night? His farewell speech. Oh, no worries, you can go on YouTube.
Yeah.
He is masterful for three reasons. And these are the three things I would tell young people who want it. Because communications is critical to business success. No, it's critical to life success.
Exactly.
That's business, right?
Right.
When you got to communicate your ideas, when you have to defend your points of view, you have to be able to communicate. So there are three things I would tell people. Number one, you have to be credible. So if whatever I'm speaking on, whatever I'm asked to speak on, like I'll be speaking up at Dartmouth on energy and the environment, then I'll speak in New York on the economics for minority businesses under Trump administration, I mean, other things. You have to be credible. That is, you have to have, you gotta convince your audience that you know what you're talking about, that you have experience, that you have credibility, right? So that's the key thing is credibility. Number one is you gotta believe what you're saying. Passion, right? Passion, you gotta, you know, part of communications, I would argue, 80% is passion. How strongly do you believe what you're saying? You probably see me in my various speeches, man. I believe what I'm saying. I may not be that smart, but I believe what I'm saying, right? Passion. And then the third thing is empathy. Empathy for the audience. So whenever I'm to speak to an audience, before I construct my speech, I'm thinking about how can I be helpful to this audience? What can I do to make their jobs, their life better? Empathy. So how can I put myself in their shoes, and then how can I add value to them? So if you do those three things, one, you're credible, which is you've done your research, your homework, whatever it is, you're knowledgeable what you're speaking about. Number two, you're passionate. You believe it. You believe what you're saying. You don't have to say words. Like you lived it, right? And that's why I always like to use stories when I give speeches about my experience, because they're real, right. And they are, and they have value to me. So that passion, when I tell them, comes across. And then empathy, right? Mm-hmm. I want to feel what you feel, Mr. and Mrs. Audience member. I want to know what's keeping you up at night. What issues are you facing that I can help you with, right? Mm-hmm. Can I give you hope? When I talk to poor people, when I do mission work around the world, we go all over the world, we do mission, we build churches, we build hospitals, we build clinics, we put in water systems in Africa and Latin America, all kinds of things. I want to know, how can I make the lives of these people better? Not how can I make myself feel better, how can I make their lives better, right? And again, back to impact. Mm-hmm. So in terms of young people communicating, those three things: be credible, do your homework, be passionate, believe what you're saying, and be empathetic, all right, of your audience, right? What do they feel? What are they concerned? Where's their pain? And how can what you're saying help them to have a better life? If you do those three things, and President Obama was a master at that. You know who else was a master at it? It was President Reagan. You can love him or leave him, but you're probably too young to remember Reagan.
I remember Reagan.
Okay. Reagan was good at that. So was Clinton, Bill Clinton. I got a picture of me and him right there, but Bill Clinton, a good friend of mine, right? Yeah. Bill and Obama and Barack, they're masters at that, those three things. And anybody can do that. Anyone. But it's key to communicating, and communications is key to success. It really is.
Okay. So you said, before I go there, well, I think you answered it all in that first one. Mm-hmm. I do got a question outside of that. So, I flipped the page. I'm like, did I flip the page?
Yeah.
Okay, so now I'm about to get into your business.
Okay.
So being a minority in the energy industry, yep, that's what you're a minority in. What obstacle you've encountered that you'll never forget, and how did you strategically overcome it? And in what way did it make you stronger as a person? So what way did it make you stronger? So one, what is the obstacle?
Yeah.
How did you overcome it? And how did it make you stronger as a person?
I think the obstacle was and is people underestimating you because of your color or because of your sex, right? Did you see the movie Hidden Figures yet?
I have not. Got that.
You gotta see it.
I'm gonna go see it.
You gotta see it. I took my three granddaughters to see it this past weekend. Because it's a perfect example of people underestimating you because of who you are, how you look, right? Mm-hmm. So the biggest challenge for people of color in business has always been, underestimating us, particularly in technology fields, right? Because you're not supposed to be that smart where you can provide solutions in technology. So I think underestimating has been a major obstacle. I think the second obstacle is lack of capital or lack of access to capital. It takes money. It takes money to grow. I know a lot of people who have great ideas, particularly women and people of color, but what they lack is the financial infrastructure to be able to sustain them so that idea can take root and it can grow, right? And so what happens is, you run out of money, you out of business. I don't care how good your idea is, if you run out of cash, you're out of business.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's been a challenge for us. That's been an obstacle for me and others like me. All right, I've been fortunate in that I'm very conservative. I'm probably the most conservative black man you ever meet. I mean, you know, when I started making money, you know, I didn't go out and get the big house and the fast car when I could have, right? I just kept tucking that money away, tucking away. So consequently, by God's grace, today in our businesses, we have no debt. I don't owe anybody nothing.
That's all.
Right? I could walk away from this thing, make a few bucks and live my life, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm conservative, right? And so I think that the access to capital has been an obstacle. Taking you seriously or underestimating you is an obstacle. And I think that either the inability or the unwillingness to initiate alliances and strategic partnerships is a problem for us. We've not done that well. We've not been trained. That's why I wrote the book about it. I wrote a book about it. Book's done very well. How do you create alliances and partnerships in business? Because what I've learned is that is key to success. If you look at every company, I don't care from Apple to IBM to ExxonMobil, whoever it is, if you peel back the onion, you will find that their success has come from their ability to build alliances and partnerships, right? Some with big companies, some with smaller companies who had great innovation and ideas, but they were able to master the art of building alliances and partnerships. And so we as minority businesses, we have to master that art. And you have to be intentional about that. So you can't, it can't be an afterthought. It's gotta be forefront of your plan and your strategy. So now when I go into deals, my first thing is, who can I partner with? Every deal I go into, every market I go into, okay, who can I partner with? We're looking to do some things now under Trump administration, and it may be gas, and it may be nuclear. I'm not in those areas now, but I know I want to get in. The fast way for me to get in is find me partners who are already in that space, build a relationship with them, right, and then have them bring me in. So now I'm at the table. Now I can show what I can do. And you have to have an incremental approach, which is, you're not going to get the big deal right away, but they want to see what you're worth and what you know. But you take a little thing, Bible talks about this, be faithful in a little, and I'll give you much.
Exactly.
So you take that little contract, that little piece they give you, all right, and you work it. You shine that thing up, that thing comes out like a diamond. And they'll see it, they say, oh, okay, then maybe she can do this.
Exactly.
And then she gets that, and then she bangs that out, right? Hits a home run with that, and you keep doing that. And that's what we've been able to do, right, in new markets. We were not in soil, you see, in 2009, we started with energy, right?
Mm-hmm.
We hadn't done any soil energy projects.
You just started it, you just went.
So I said, hey. We can do this, right?
Right.
So hire the people, train them, put some money into the deal. You know, our first year operation, we installed maybe 4 solar panels. Last year combined, we've installed now over 500,000 solar panels.
Wow.
Right? Started from nothing to something. That approach I'm telling you about, that's how we did it, right? Take a little piece. We have more we don't want to get into. Who's in it? Who can I, how can I partner with them?
Mm-hmm.
I partner by showing value. I show the value, get to the table, show what I can do, knock out every deal I do, even little some tiny projects, knock it out of the ballpark. Keep doing that, and then before you know it. And not only are you growing with it, but you're building a name for yourself. So now in the industry, people come to me, say, hey, Bob, we're trying to do this deal. We want you on our team. Different dynamic, see? Because you've been able to do those things. So I think that's how I would answer that. It's not hard. It's not hard to do. It's not complicated. But if you have discipline and you need mentorship too, we need people to help us.
Yeah.
Me, you, all of us. Okay, who you are. Steve Jobs had mentors.
Yes.
Right? We all need people to help us. Right? I have written 5, soon to be 8 books on business, and I've studied a lot of successful people. I've never met in my travels, in my 30 years of research, I've never met a single woman or man who did it by themselves. And the wise ones know better than to say that. The wise ones will say, you know what? I have a lot of help along the way. I didn't do this by myself. The wise ones. Now, the crazy ones will say, oh, yeah, I did it by myself. But we all know it's a lie. It's a lie. It's not true. So, you know, you got to have that too. So I think those are the things I would say.
Yeah.
I focus on.
Okay. So you mentioned something that I thought was like key to so this interview in your TEDxco interview or speech. You said create a future,
right.
Work backwards,
right.
As you pivot your way to the present.
Right.
The name of this show is called Controlling Your Future.
Oh, really?
Yes. And that's the focus, to give all the resources for youth and at-risk and ex-offenders and anyone that is disadvantaged to get back in control of their
future.
So one of the things I wanted to ask you is, not pivoting from that, but you got a new book, you said, that you're writing called Pivot, Point, and Intelligence.
Well, it's called Pivot, Point, Intelligence.
Intelligence. So it's one, 3 different words or just?
Well, it's good point. It's 3 words.
Okay.
Although Pivot, Point is hyphenated. Well, I hyphenated, it doesn't have to be, but Pivot, Point, Intelligence.
Okay.
So you heard of emotional intelligence?
Yes.
I've now created what's called pivot point intelligence.
So let's talk about it. So I know you gotta go, but
I do. Go ahead, but let's not go this way.
Okay, let's not. So let's talk about the purpose and why you created a new flow for that.
Okay. So pivot point intelligence was the idea for that came from my fourth book on alliances and partnerships. Mm-hmm. I study companies who were successful at creating alliances and partnerships. I mean, big companies and some small ones too. Toyota, Procter & Gamble, Microsoft, all these, who were masters at creating alliances and partnerships. And from that research, there was a common thread I kept seeing, and that was that these companies were able to what I call pivot in their business strategy so they could move from one alliance to another and not lose momentum or lose their value creation opportunity. Mm-hmm. So the idea of being able to change your strategy in midstream, right? Mm-hmm. You ever play basketball?
Of course not.
Okay. See, I'm a frustrated basketball player because right? I love the sport, never was good enough to play professionally, but I love the sport, right? Mm-hmm. Well, a basketball player, a good example is when he or she's driven down the court, the opposition is there, you know, they pivot and move in a different direction to avoid the obstacle. It's the same way in business, right? So as we are putting in our business strategies and we're executing it, what we find is the environment is always different than what we thought it was going to be. Mm-hmm. So because of that, we have to be able to pivot in our strategy, but not lose momentum when we do that. Because when you're playing ball, right, you got momentum. So the key to get around your opponent is to pivot, but at the same speed in which you are moving. So I use that analogy of pivoting in business. So I call it pivot point intelligence. How do you do it, and when do you know, and how do you know when to do it, and then when to do it, okay. Right? Those are things I talk about in the book. I use examples of different companies and athletes and all that who have mastered the art of pivot point intelligence, mm-hmm. knowing how to change direction, mm-hmm. how to change strategy, and not lose momentum or lose opportunity in the process. Mm-hmm. That's what that book is about.
Okay.
And that should be out, I hope, this year, but I got three books I'm working on, so I'm not sure, but that's what that book's about.
Okay. Well, I can't wait to gain access to it.
It'll be exciting. I'll make sure you're the first ones to get it.
All right, so this will be my last question.
It has to be.
It has to be. What testimony that you've heard from someone that you've changed their life in a good way or bad way that has helped you help others that have really made an impact on you?
This is going to surprise you.
Mm-hmm.
My answer will surprise you.
Okay.
You're probably too young.
You keep saying
that. You say young. There's a group called Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Mm.
And they were a funk group back in the 70s.
I remember Earth, Wind, and Fire.
The leader of the group was a man named Maurice White.
Mm-hmm.
He recently passed. Very good. Very good. Maurice was the founder, leader, drummer, right? And he has a book out. You got to read it.
Okay.
It's Maurice White, My Life with Earth, Wind, and Fire. And he talks about his life and talks about his time creating Earth, Wind, and Fire and the songs that they created. You're probably too young, remember the songs.
Absolutely.
Or, you know,
keep going.
Keep your head to the sky.
Yes.
Evil, and that's the way.
So I was born in 72, if that helps you in.
You're a baby still.
But in 72, we were playing 60 songs.
Yeah, okay. Well, they got started in 71, 72.
Okay.
So you were born, right? So, but here's the thing. The impact to me, what Mari said, every song he wrote, part of his criteria was he wanted that song to change somebody's life. When they heard that song, keep your head to the sky. He wanted every song they wrote, he said in his biography, he only wrote songs that would change people's lives. Mm-hmm. That's the same thing that drives me in business. Whatever I do, I want to change people's lives. Mm-hmm. I want what I invest my life into to have the impact of changing people's lives. That's what drives me. So I won't do things that won't change people's lives. I had the opportunity to own some liquor stores in Baltimore. Could have made a lot of money doing that. I didn't do it. Because I don't want to change people's lives in a negative way, in a positive way. You know, so there's certain things I won't do. Businesses I won't do because it will have a detrimental effect on humanity. Mm-hmm. Anything I do, I want to change people's lives in a positive way, in a helpful way. And Maurice White, Verve in the Fire, that was his goal with his music. And he was successful. Guys like me who were trying to find their spiritual way during the 70s, you know, we believed in God, but we didn't have a relationship with God. Well, Earth from the Fire's music helped guys like me to gel and to make that connection with God. And of course, we grew, became stronger. But as young men, you know, we dealt with, you know, sex and drugs and, you know, all the pressures of, you know, adulthood. And didn't have a way to find our way, but his music helped guys like me to find their spiritual way. That's deep.
It is.
That's deep. So that's the same thing I want to do in business. Right? You follow me on that?
Of course.
And that's important for you too. Yes. Because what you're doing has potential to change people's lives. Mm-hmm. So I want to encourage you. Right? I look, it's tough sometimes. Right? But you just stick with it. And, you know, stay close to God, stay on your knees, right? And He will give you what you need to make whatever your purpose is, to make it come true. Trust me on that one. And it may take time. I can take some storage, old man. He don't always come when you want him. But Mama, you say, but he's always on time.
What an exciting interview. The jewels and nuggets are developing your communication skills. In doing that, you will need credibility, passion, and empathy. Understand what your major obstacles are and connect so you are gaining access to capital. Bring value to your customers and show what you are about by learning how to build strategic partnerships to get your foot in the door. Until next week, this has been Tarsha Weary, the host of Controlling Your Future.
Stay young and hard.
Ah, 'cause you'll never